Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. This morning, amen, I just want to simply teach, amen, a message we know we've heard probably 1,000 times. So today it's going to be 1,001 more, amen. But simply the title of this message is A Man Named Jesus. A Man Named Jesus. As you're standing, you can open up your Bibles to John chapter 1 and verse 1. John chapter 1 and verse 1, amen. John chapter 1, verse 1 through 3 reads, In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God. All things were made by Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. Amen. Why don't we put your Bible down and let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us here one more time. Thank you, Jesus, for allowing these doors, God, to stay open unto us. Thank you, Lord, that your door, God, is always open, Jesus. Lord, we're very grateful to be in this place one more time. God, be with all the Sunday school teachers, God. Touch them and anoint them. We give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated in Jesus' name. Amen. In the very beginning, God was there in existence. Amen. There's a lot of questions that people that don't necessarily believe in God, they ask a question, you know, who made God? Was God always there? There had to have been a start with this person that we call God, this person that we call Jesus. There had to have been a start, because in everything in life, we know that there is a start, and usually with that start comes with a finish. The Bible makes very clear that John chapter 1 gives you that answer. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. And so we know that the very first day that ever came about as we know it, the very first, as time began, as we know it, the very first hour, the very first second that God created, God was already there. And so then gives you the answer that, you know, God was always there in existence, that there is a God. And every amount or a lot of different religions all around the world, they believe in some form of higher power. I remember years ago I was taking college classes at the branch, and I was taking a public speech class, and we talked about we each took turns. We gave a little speech about some type of topic that we found a lot of interest in. And so, of course, I talked to the teacher, and then I asked him if I could, you know, kind of talk about this. And he said, yeah, but just kind of stay away from the terms Bible and Jesus and stuff. So I kind of, you know, I talked about it, and I asked the class, I said, who believes in some form of higher power? And just about every single person, whether they believed in Jesus or whether they believed in the Creator, as us Navajos call, you know, every person raised their hand that they believed in some form of higher power. And so I want to talk about simply a man named Jesus. Does anybody believe that this Bible is the Word of God? Does anybody believe that this Bible is truth? Amen. John chapter 1 tells us, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. We jump down to verse 14. It tells us, "And the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth." And so we know that in the beginning was God. And that same God, the same God of the Old Testament, became flesh. He put on a robe of flesh as a man puts on a jacket. 1 Timothy 3 and verse 16 tells us, talks about this great God. A lot of people like, and I like John chapter 3 and verse 16 before I ever came to church. You know, a lot of people quote that and they believe in that. I like something, you know, 1 Timothy 3 and 16. I like that verse. 1 Timothy 3:16 tells us, "And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory." Amen. So this same God that was there from the very first hour, the very first second, that as time, as we know it, began. This very God of the Old Testament, this very same God that created everything, everything that we see and everything that we can't see. This same God, verse Timothy 3:16 tells us that this same God was manifest in flesh. Amen. Is anybody thankful that God stepped off of His throne and came to a sin-sick world, amen, to save His own people? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. And so those of us, we know the meaning of the name Jesus. But allow me just to preach about, amen, this man named Jesus. The name Jesus means Savior. The name Jesus means the Messiah. He is the Savior. That's why Matthew chapter 1 and verse 21 tells us, "And she shall bring forth a son, and thou shalt call his name Jesus, for he shall save his people from their sins." Amen. This man named Jesus is the Savior. Amen. Amen. And we know that the last name, Christ, means the anointed one, means the chosen one. So we have the anointed one, the chosen one. This man, he is the Savior. He is the man named Jesus. Amen. Is anybody glad that we know the name Jesus? Is anybody thankful that not only do we know about Jesus, amen, but we have a personal relationship and fellowship with Him. Amen. I've said this before, but Jesus desires more than just relationship. He desires more of fellowship. I can explain that because, you know, as for me being a Navajo, we have a lot of relatives. Amen. And when I married my wife, I never seen so many people in one house. I go to my in-law's house, and there's just so many people, and it's really awesome. And so every person in this place, we can all agree that we have relatives, that we have some form of relationship with them, whether it be aunts or uncles, cousins, nephews, grandpas, grandmas. Some of you are thinking of them right now, that, you know, you have an aunt or uncle, but you haven't seen them in probably over a year. And I'm also preaching to myself. I know I have a lot of aunties on my mom's side. I see them probably once, twice a year. I am related to them, but I don't actually spend time with them. And so God desires the same thing. A lot of people say, I know God, but they don't take the time to actually know him and spend time with him. I run into a lot of people here on the streets. You know, I'm talking to them. We're walking downtown or something like that, walking through Walmart. And, you know, there are a lot of people, they say, I know God, but they don't actually spend time with him. That's like saying, I know my auntie, but I see her once, twice a year. And so God desires more than just relationship. God desires fellowship. And fellowship is simply defined as spending time with a person. Every time we hang out with brothers and sisters and we pray, if we're all eating together, we always pray, Lord, bless this fellowship, because we're spending time together. And God desires the same thing. God desires more than just relationship, more than just saying, I know about this God, but rather spending time with him. Spending time with him through prayer and spending time with him by coming to church. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. You know, when I was a young person, I grew up in a church, and I knew about God, and I knew that there was a God, but I didn't quite have an understanding of who this God was. And so this morning, I just wanted to simply fall back on a message I believe that is the foundation of every message. Amen. A man named Jesus. When I was younger, I grew up in church, and I remember, you know, running around, and I remember one point they were taking up offering, and I was probably 7, 8 years old. They were taking up offering, and back then they would pass a bucket around, kind of like what we do here. And there was this bunch of money in there, and I was 7, 8 years old, and I was like, man, people are passing out money. And so I grabbed $20, and I believe I grabbed $20 and I put it in my pocket. I was like, hey, it's free money. These people are passing it around. And so I had a form. Of course, my parents, they told me afterward, and I had a clear understanding of what this offering was. So I grew up in a form of church. I grew up knowing about God. And I grew up in church, and about 12 years old, we stopped going. And so from 12 years old to 16 years old, when I first came into this church, I made it a point to try to read the Bible. Try to read the Bible from front to end when I wasn't even in church, because I desired, you know, to know about this God. I desired to know about him. And I told of you some of my testimonies, how that I would pray every single night. I was so confused about how there was only one God. I thought that there was, you know, three gods. I thought I had to pray to the Father, the Holy Ghost, and Jesus. And so every single night I would pray. Every single night, you know, I said it before, and I'll say it one more time, but, you know, that's the reason why I'm so passionate about the oneness of God. Because I was so confused as a young person. I would lie awake on the couch that we slept that I slept in, and I would lie awake as the lights went off, and I would pray, and I would say, Lord, good night, Father, good night, Holy Ghost. And then I would pray, Lord, forgive me if I'm giving you more attention to you. I would pray that constantly every single night. But I'm so glad that I came to this church. I'm so glad that I made an effort, not by only coming, but by hearing the word and studying the word of God. Amen. Amen. So I simply want to teach this message, a man named Jesus. Amen. When I first came into this church, amen, we had an awesome pastor, and I remember Brother Stewart, and They always preached about receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. They always preached about being baptized in Jesus' name. And when I was filled with the Spirit of God, I was actually with my sister. We were coming back from Twin Lakes. We were driving in the car at night. I believe it was like 10, 11 o'clock at night. We were driving back into Gallup. And I remember just getting the need to pray. We started praying for our whole family. You know, I was sitting in the passenger seat, and we just started to pray. I was praying for my family. But I remember right passing China Springs. I remember that I remember seeing lights. I remember seeing the lights of Gallup. And that's when God filled me with the Holy Ghost. The only thing I remember is my hands were lifted up in the car, and the words of my mouth just began to flow. And the only thing I remember is just hearing myself speak in tongues, and I couldn't stop what I was saying. And that was the greatest experience in my life. Amen. Can anybody agree that the greatest experience that you ever felt here on earth was being filled with the Spirit of God? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. And from that day, God changed my life. God changed me from the inside out. You know, I was the type of person, I was starting to go crazy. And, you know, some of you heard a couple of my testimonies, but I'm not the one who likes to talk about my past. But at the same time, I don't want to forget where God has brought me from. And so I come from a family who I lost two uncles. I lost them both to alcohol. And to this day, I was on that same path. I was on that same path. I used to drink with my uncle. But just seeing the effects of what alcohol can do, you know, it just hurts me. And I see people on the streets, and I see people and young people and people that had jobs. And this a couple months ago, we passed out jackets, and we ran into a guy who had recently lost his wife. And you can tell that he was a man that, you know, didn't necessarily walk on the streets his whole life. But this man had some nice boots on. This man had nice clothes on. But he told Brother David and I, he goes, you know, I just recently lost my wife, and I don't know what to do. And so this man was in pain. This man was in agony, and he just turned to alcohol. I'm here to tell you that there is a God that you can turn to, amen? That if you're ever in need, that if you're ever, amen, if you're ever in pain, if you're ever hurting, that there is this God. His name is Jesus. You can call out his name. You can call out his name in the middle of the night and say, Jesus, I need you. Jesus, intervene in my life. Jesus, intervene, God. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. A man named Jesus. As I had mentioned, this very God that was always there in the beginning, this very God was manifest in the flesh. We understand that why he was manifest in the flesh. Throughout the Old Testament, if you read about it, there were to require the remission of sin, it required a sacrifice. It required blood to wash away sin. And so one day a year, they would sacrifice. They would find a lamb that was without blemish. They would find a lamb and sacrifice it. They would sacrifice it upon the altar, and they would pray to God for forgiveness. And so I said this, you know, somewhat of a parable, not necessarily a parable, but I always talk about it. And when we used to preach over at the detox center or over at the senior ministry, is that this great God, just imagine that, you know, some person in Alaska, how, you know, say it's snowing so much, and there was a campsite, and those people 10 to 15 miles away that were stranded and that they were lost in the snow. But this campsite had some great people that were survivors, and they had one, especially one of the greatest. And so 15 miles away, people get stuck in this snow blizzard. And so from that campsite, one person goes and tries to make it and tries to save those people. That person ends up, you know, getting lost in the snow, and one after another, until the greatest survivalist of all time comes out and saves these people. And that is the same way God is. God sent prophet after prophet to save his own people. Some people listened to the prophets, and some people killed the prophets, and some people just did not listen at all. And so God had to come in flesh. God had to come to his own people and to save his own people. God came, amen, as a lamb slain from the foundation of the world. He was that perfect sacrifice for you and I. He was that perfect sacrifice, that death we so deserve from our sin. Jesus took your place, amen. And so I simply want to teach and let you know that God loves you so much. God loves you so, so much. A lot of times we don't hear that, but God cares about you. God has your name and God has your number. God cares about you. God loves you, and I know that, you know, sometimes we don't hear that enough, but God cares enough about you. Amen. I did a little, you know, some little bit of math months ago about how that there is probably 25,000 people here in Gallup, and there's probably 300 of us that know the truth here in Gallup. And out of that 300 to 25, I believe it was like 0.1%. So you had a 99% chance to fail. You had a 99% chance to, you had a 99% chance on your way to a place we don't like to talk about. You had a 99% chance to die in your sin. But that 1%, God loves you enough, amen, to bring you to this truth and to bring you to this revelation that there is only one God, and that, amen, that God can fill you with his spirit and that you can get baptized in the name Jesus. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 1. Man, it's good to see you. Amen, Brother Derek, amen, and Sister Felicia. Man, thank you, Jesus. Amen. You know, I'm so thankful for them. When my wife and I, when we first got married, you know, we had nobody to turn to. Amen. And I believe God moved on Brother Derek's heart, and they invited us to stay with them. And we actually lived with them for about 3 months. And Brother Derek said, you know, that was from God, because normally I would not ask anybody to live with me. Amen. So I'm very thankful, amen, that Brother Derek and Sister Felicia opened up their home to us. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. 1 Corinthians chapter 15 and verse 1 tells us, moreover, brethren, I declare unto you the gospel which I preach unto you, which also you have received, and wherein ye stand, by which ye are saved, if ye keep in memory what I preached unto you, unless ye have believed in vain. For I delivered unto you first of all that which I also received, how that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he rose again the third day, according to the Scripture. Amen. The death, the burial, and resurrection of this great God. Christ died for our sins, amen, death, according to the scripture. And he was buried, amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And that he rose again the third day. Death, burial, and resurrection is the only way someone is going to make it to heaven. Amen. Death, burial, and resurrection. Dying to your sins. Dying to your old ways of life. And turning your life to God. And getting buried in the name of Jesus through baptism. And receiving the gift of the Holy Ghost. With the evidence of speaking in tongues. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And amen. Jesus, amen, is here this morning, and he is calling you by name. If you haven't already been baptized in the name Jesus, I strongly encourage you this morning, we can baptize you in that lovely name of Jesus. If you haven't already received the gift of the Holy Ghost, God can fill you this morning with that gift. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. The same God that created everything, the same God of the Old Testament is here, and he is alive. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. That same God is our Savior. That same God is my Savior. Isaiah 43 and verse 11 tells us, Isaiah 43 and verse 11. This is God talking. He said, I am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. What I want you to understand is that this God of the Old Testament, he's the only Savior. Amen. He reveals himself, amen, through Jesus. He is Jesus Christ, is the same God of the Old Testament. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forevermore. This Jesus Christ is not another part of God, but he is God himself. The Bible states that there is only one Savior. God of the Old Testament said, I am the Lord, and beside me there is no Savior. Amen. Jump over a couple chapters. Isaiah chapter 45 and verse 21 tells us, tell ye and bring them near. Yea, let them take counsel together who hath declared this from the ancient time and who hath told it from the time. Have not I the Lord, and there is no God else beside me. A just God and a Savior, there is none beside me. Look unto me and be ye saved, O the ends of the earth, for I am God and there is none else. I have sworn by myself, the word is gone out of my mouth in righteousness and shall not return, that unto me every knee shall bow and every tongue shall swear. Amen. That sounds like a familiar verse. That unto me every knee shall bow and every tongue shall swear. But you jump over into the New Testament, and Philippians chapter 10 tells us that at the very mention of the name Jesus, that every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that he is the Lord. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Is anybody thankful to know this great God, Jesus? Hallelujah. Thank you, Almighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. This great God wants to know you more. Amen. Does anybody have a desire to know more about God? Amen. Thank you, Jesus. As we're in Isaiah, turn with me to Isaiah chapter 6. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Is anybody thankful that we serve a God that is the only God? Is anybody thankful that we serve, amen, the true God? Amen. Isaiah chapter 6 and verse 1 tells us, in the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. High and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. If we can stand to our feet, and his train filled the temple. Amen. And in those times, in that year, what you got to understand is that kings of that time, they would tie, you know, portions of the flags that they had conquered, enemies that they have fought and overcome. They would take pieces of their flag and they would tie it to the king. And so when the king would walk down the city, they would, following the king, they would see all of his victories. They would see all of the enemies that he had overcome. He would see, you know, different victories that he had won. I'm here to tell you that when you have a victory, your victory is following you. Amen. And this great God, his train filled the temple. This great God, this man named Jesus, conquered everything. This man named Jesus has all power. He had conquered sin and he had conquered death. His train fills the temple. Every victory that he has overcome, his victory is following him. His victory is with him. Amen. Why don't you lift your hands and thank God for him overcoming everything. God has been in your footstep. God has been in your position. And God has overcome. God has overcome what you're facing right now. God has overcome what you're dealing with right now. God has the victory. And if you put your trust in him, God will give you the victory. This man named Jesus, this man named Jesus desires fellowship with you. This man named Jesus desires fellowship with you. This man named Jesus loves you so much. He stepped off of his throne and robed himself in flesh and came, amen, and died for our sins. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Almighty God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Why don't you just lift your hands here this morning? Thank you, Almighty God. Thank you, Almighty God. Lord, you alone are worthy, Jesus. You alone are worthy, Jesus. You alone, God, are worthy. Amen. This man named Jesus. This man named Jesus is here this morning, and he is calling you by name. This man named Jesus is here this morning, and he is calling you by name. Sometimes we wait for loud music. Sometimes we wait for the right rhythm. Amen. But there's a scripture in the New Testament how that Jesus comes on the scene and he's walking with his disciples. And this man begins to cry out as he sees Jesus making his way. And he said, you know, Son of David, have mercy on me. Or he said, Son of David, has thou come to destroy us before the time? This man was possessed with an evil spirit. And this evil spirit, every demon understands that there is coming a time, amen, that Jesus is going to lock them up. And so they understood who this man was, Jesus. They understood that this was the very God that had created them. Even though he was with his disciples, that those two men that were possessed with those devils, they cried out, are you come to destroy us before the time? And I can just imagine the puzzled look on his disciples' face, like, what are these two people talking about? What are these two people talking about, how this man is going to destroy them before their time? I'm here to tell you, God is in this place right now. Jesus is walking back and forth in this place right now. Amen. If you can lift your hands one more time to this great God, and amen, that had created everything, that had created everything that we see and cannot see. This very God that is trained fills the temple. This very God that has overcome everything. This very God that has created everything. Everything. This very God is here this morning, and he is calling you by name. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Almighty God. I just encourage you, amen, to know this God named Jesus. Amen. To make it a point more than just relationship, but fellowship. More than just seeing God once a weekend, but spending time with him and getting to know him. Amen. And like I said, if you haven't already been baptized, please see Pastor or any one of the preachers, and we would love to baptize you. We would love to feel, amen, and hear that water running. Amen. So I encourage you to know this man named Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.